Get it?
Cool. Cool. Well, thank you, everybody. Hello, hello. Everybody still awake? I know this is after lunch, so if you have to feel like a nap is coming along and you need to rest your head, I'll allow you to put your head down for a few minutes. Thank you first and foremost for coming out. We appreciate it. And hopefully you get the best out of the labs, the workshop here today. One disclaimer, and I'm going to be the bad guy to say the disclaimer because I don't want Chris, my partner here, to get the brunt of it, is we have limited resources. And I appreciate all the people out there that came to see the workshop. We do have limited resources, so everyone may not be able to participate, but the good news is that I'm going to make it so that if you did want to participate from home and follow through the lab, I'm going to make the resources available for a week after the summit, right? So if you don't get to participate today, do not feel bad. I'm going to give you my card. I'm going to give you direct resources you can consume from home. You can step through the lab, and you can tell me how it went, right? So don't feel bad if you're not able to actually do hands-on today. But the limited resources part is my thing. It's very difficult to spin up enough clouds for, I don't know, 150 people in the room. So just being totally perfect and honest about it. So just wanted to put it out there. But
cool, let's do it.
So starting out, so I wanted to first introduce my co-worker here, Chris. He's here. We're partnering up on this lab, so we're going to talk a little bit about Chris in the next slide. But just to kind of give you some information about me, I work for Rackspace, if you haven't realized that by the Racker shirt that I have on. Cloud solution architect. I work in a private cloud space. Just some of my things is I've been in IT for probably a little bit too long. I love motorcycles. I am an actual DJ, so if you need a DJ for your weddings or your parties, please call me up. you know, always about living life now. I believe that, you know, tomorrow's never promised to you, so I'm all about that. These are just some of the companies I've worked for. Follow me on Twitter or send me hate notes on Twitter, please, you know, welcome to do that, as well as my blog is there. If you want some other OpenStack information, I put some stuff out there every once in a while. So I'll let
cool.
Chris take over.
Hey guys, my name is Chris Woodard. I've been at Rackspace for 10 years, RPC for 4. Here to show that anybody can do this job, even somebody with a Louisiana school education. So, it's first time presenting. Walter was kind enough to let me join him up here on stage and stumble along. So, you know, without further ado.
No, I need the support, and he's a great guy, and you know, he probably has a lot more experience than me because he actually gets to touch OpenStack every day. I just get to say OpenStack about 200 times a day, but he actually gets the chance to touch OpenStack.
That's right.
So. Listen to him, not to me, is basically what I'm saying. So very, really quick and simple ground rules. Again, we're all adults, so I know I don't have to say this stuff, but I'm just going to say it. If you need to answer a phone call, please step outside. You know, try not to take the call while inside here. One of the other requirements is you must ask questions, right? So if you have a question, please raise your hand, ask the question. Don't keep it to yourself. Don't tweet it to me later and with bad words. Ask the question now, so I can try to help you. Take any side conversations that you need outside. You know, again, like I said, mainly because I like hearing myself talk only, not everybody else, so please go outside if you have to. Like I said before, because we have limited resources, I'm gonna ask that you guys group together. And I know this is a weird thing for techies because we don't like to sit too close to each other, but I'm gonna need you guys to work in groups of at least 3 or more. So everyone can get a chance to actually touch the keyboard and do things, but I'm going to need you guys to figure out how to group up together so that everybody can get the most out of it. The materials for the workshop are at this link here. Google URL shorteners are case sensitive, so you must type it exactly like that. And again, it's going to be on another slide later, so don't worry about trying to grab that now. But again, that's where all the resources are. Oh, it's moving too fast. Why is it skipping past that? There we go. All right, so again, groups of 3 or more. So look around, stake out who you want to group up with now. Each group will be given a student ID and some instructions to connect to your OpenStack cloud. Usually I give that as a handout because I made a mistake and forgot to print it because, again, I'm just not on my game this week. The materials or actually the OpenStack cloud information, how you connect to it, is going to be on the GitHub repository at that same link that we showed before. So each team will have to pick, so I'm going to go through and assign team numbers, and then from there you'll go into the Git repository and pick up your information. So what you're getting as a team is each team will be given an OpenStack Liberty Release Cloud, and access to another server called a StackStorm server. StackStorm is an open source piece of software that does auto remediation. We're going to talk more about StackStorm later, but that's what you're going to be getting, is a fully functioning OpenStack Liberty release cloud and access to a StackStorm server to do your automated recovery. And last thing is that we're also going to be leveraging Nagios as our monitoring platform to be able to monitor each of your clouds so that you will be able to kind of get a shortcut to figuring out what's wrong with your cloud, because Chris is going to share some information with you soon about your cloud that you're going to be curious to find out. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to my partner in crime, Chris, cool. here to get you All guys right. started.
All right. Services auto recovery. Whoops. Okay, looks like I'm suffering from the same thing.
Yeah, I did the same thing.
All right. So, I mean, you know, services are going to fail. That is a part of any OpenStack environment or any, you know, infrastructure. This is, you know, this is normal. So what we're kind of looking at here is OpenStack core services. There is a big amount or a large amount of overlap there. If one service fails, it can cause a chain reaction and, you know, cause multiple service failures there. Recovering a service is pretty much simple as restarting that service, or, you know, there could be a lot of troubleshooting involved, try to track down what actually is going on. Ways to monitor some of these services, you know, depending on your monitoring platform, you can identify what is actually failing and then troubleshoot from there. You know, let Rackspace do it. Lots of prayers. I like that. So automated remediation, the ability to identify and verify system failures with a focus on taking actions in response to an event in an automated fashion. So, I mean, that kind of like, that's what we're trying to do here. You know, you don't want to get that call at 3 o'clock in the morning. You just want to see that this issue was resolved. Okay, what cleanup is there going to be afterwards?
It just as a side note, this definition is something I created, so don't try and steal it and put it on Wikipedia, all right? This is my definition, so if you steal it, you got to give me some money towards it, all right?
This is our brave new world. Okay, so we were talking earlier, everyone could group up. I think we have 30 environments, yep. So hopefully groups of three. I think there's like 20-something rows, but basically what we're going to do is you guys will log into this environment. Service is always going to be broken, or will already be broken. You're going to log in and determine what's broken and go ahead and get that service back up and running. And then from there, you know, we're going to start talking about StackStorm and doing the automated recovery process. Okay, so this will be the link to the Git.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come out and start assigning some team numbers since, I forgot to print it out. These guys don't count. They're my coworkers. They don't count. So you guys are going to be team one, okay? So who's my three over here? You got to find one more. You got to find one more dude. Who wants to join these two gentlemen? Somebody has to. All right, there we go. You guys are team two. You guys have three at least. But there's only two people. I can count. That's two. You got to have three or more. Three or more. Yeah. You can have all four. You guys can work together. I'm fine with that. Right? You guys okay with that? It doesn't matter. You can let them do all the work. It's fine. Okay. Well, you can do all the work. Perfect. All right. You guys can be team three, okay? All right. You got three people over here who's interested? Come on. All right, team four. Remember your numbers. It's important. All right, three at least. Okay, team five. You guys want to participate? All right, anybody willing to join these guys? They need one more. I thought you guys came to Doodle Labs. Okay, team six. I mean, it makes me feel better that everybody's not jumping at it, so, I mean, I'm fine with that. Oh, now you're playing with me.
These guys right here?
Yeah, you guys will be team seven. You three will be team seven. Team eight?
You guys all together?
They're team nine. Yep, team nine. You guys going to work together? All right, you team 10, okay? You gonna work together, ladies? You need one more. Okay, you're team 11. We need one more for team 12 here. All right, team 12, you got it, perfect. You guys gonna work together? Cool. All right, team 13. Awesome. Anybody? You need one more body. I'm not gonna tell you until you tell me.
You guys are gonna do four or just get one more?
You guys all wanna work together?
Okay.
All right, team 14, okay? All right, team 15. You have three, you guys wanna work together? All right, team 16, yes. You want one more for you? Who wants to work with these guys?
What's up? Working with these guys?
Come on, I would work with this guy. Guys? I would trust this guy.
Okay, cool.
I'm not asking you to give him your car keys. I just want you to work with him for a lab.
So I think
team 17.
Cool. And these guys, so these guys are group 18?
18, right, team 18. Remember your numbers, it's important, all right? You guys want to work together? Huh? You don't want to work together? He shook his head no. All right, team 19. All right. 20? You guys want to, you going to find a third for this guy right here? We need a third for 21, team 21. Everybody wants to be 21 again. Come on. Or if you're 21 now, then you will want to be 21 soon. All right, we need one more for 21 right here. There we go. I appreciate that. Brave new world. All right. You guys are going to work together? All right. You have four. That's perfect. 20, you're our team 22. 22 is your number.
How you guys are working together? All one group? Or three?
All right. You need one more to make two teams then, if that's what you're going for.
Okay. Cool.
What was your number? Thank you. Team 23. All right. You guys want to work together?
You guys all.
All right. 24. Team 24. Yeah. Remember your numbers.
Let's do this row.
25. You're going to have to lift and shift if you want to work with those guys. All right. You're going to work together? You guys? 26. Team 26. 27. 28. You three. 28. Team 29. Now, the problem is I only have one cloud left, and I got a lot of people in this row. Actually, I did pretty good with divvying up. You got to give me credit for that, at least. You got to give me at least credit. It's a room full of people. Man, she's tough. What's your name? Will you work? Okay, we'll figure that out later. All right, so I only have one last cloud for Team 30. I'm going to let you guys arm wrestle it out. You think you can take them? What do you think? All right. Can I offer these guys team 30? You're gonna judge me for it? All right, so what happens is you guys will be team 30. I won't include you unless you wanna be included with them. Okay, so everyone else here, you will get dedicated resources on my cloud account for a week to do this lab on your own, all right? So when it's over, come talk to me, I got you. All right.
Cool.
Remember your numbers. So if you go into this link up here, you'll see there's a folder that says lab assignments. Each one of those will be named slide 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, right? So you assume where I'm going with this. If you're team 1, you look at slide 1. If you're team 10, you look at slide 10. If you're team 30, you look at slide 30, okay? And that's how you're going to get your information. So let me know you're getting there. Let me know you're able to pull it up.
You guys getting connected?
Everybody getting connected. You get the concept of what I'm going with there. If you use someone else's information, you will be fighting with them for the lab.
Yeah.
So I only encourage you to do that. So make sure you use the slide that coordinates with your team number.
I've already connected to our summit.
Sorry, guys. You good?
Yeah, I'll certainly.
I appreciate that. Everything should go wrong. Yeah. Raise your hand if you are having problems getting to the environment. Okay, look at that. Your hand went up immediately.
You're,
I like that.
You're connected?
Yeah. But I don't get anything here.
No, it should be. Everyone's been pulling it up. Z. try.
Yeah, you know what? Do you have like a note?
HDK.
A word pad, yes, please. Open it with
can
word pad.
Can you guys get to it?
It's very hard for you to read it. But yes, you should be able to SSH to that using an SSH client.
Try just going to
WordPad. Yeah, much better. See? So you should be able to SSH to that IP address, dash L, and then student 01. I'm not sure.
So this is from which?
So you use the IP address
in
Google.
Okay.
That's from
try to bring something up in the browser.
Well, I guess with PuTTY, you have to use PuTTY.
And then there's Ubuntu.
Yes. So what I want you to do is once you get connected to your environment, you can start with the instructions in step one that's in the root of that GitHub repository. So step one is just basically having you log into your cloud, click around, execute a few commands. You're not doing anything too fancy in step one. I want you to get familiar. I want you to get connected to the cloud first.
Yeah. I'm not sure why you're not getting out.
Yeah.
So try to bring up another URL.
You try to SSH to that IP address using student 01 and that password. Yeah, so for Verizon, those credentials work. But to do a SSH, you need to use the other credentials. They're not the same. I didn't want to leave that wide open with an admin and fake passwords. It just felt wrong. Beautiful. All right, I seen one person connect, so that means I know it works. So good night. Thank you, everybody, for coming. No, I can't leave yet.
All right. Try to bring up that browser.
Are you guys better now? Awesome. It makes me so happy.
URL shortener. Yeah. Pop a new tab and just go to.
Raise your hands if you're having complications. All right, look at that. I love him. I love him when they go up fast like that. I'm gonna squeeze by you guys. How you doing? You all right?
Are you guys getting a 404 connecting to the?
Okay, what's going on?
Oh, admin. Okay.
So yeah, so expand that window a little bit more so you can see the rest of it.
Okay.
So it's telling you there that the Verizon credentials are admin in that. But to log into the server, you need to use student 01. All right. Sorry. Okay, so let me put some clarification out there. There are two sets of credentials to use. How'd you get to Stack Store?
Z capital O.
No. OpenStack server.
Sure, yeah.
That's what you want to connect to. Yeah, we are already there. Okay, perfect. Yeah, you can't get to the other one. Sorry. You'll need that IP for something else, not to log into. So there's two sets of credentials on that, right? There's a set of credentials, student 01, that logs you into your OpenStack server. Then there's another credential, which is admin, which gives you Horizon access. They're two different sets of credentials. You got to use them for their different purpose. If you're trying to get to Horizon, you use admin and password.
Can you go to Git?
If you're trying to get to it from SSH, you need to use student 01 and the password that's presented there on the handout. Yes. I'll show you Nagio's credentials will be in the next step. So you'll get to that. All right. So right now I just want you to follow step one, connect to your OpenStack cloud, connect to Horizon, click around, see if things are working, connect to it over SSH, execute a few commands, see if it's working. I'm just trying to build you up to being familiar with the environment. I've learned that if you start the lab off jumping right into it, it's usually not successful. So I just want to get you guys built up. No, you can log in. Log in, do what you want. Just don't break your cloud yet. Don't break it yet. You can break it later when I'm done. Okay, so once you master step one, feel free to move on to step two. So step two is where Chris kind of explained to you that every last one of you guys are running a cloud that's broken. And I did that on purpose. It wasn't by mistake. So everybody's cloud here has a service that is broken. And not broken in the sense of I've messed up the config file and you got to figure it out on your own. Broken is in the sense that a process or service may or may not be running. Right? So just go on my hints there. The top of step two actually points you to Nagios dashboard. If you're not familiar with what Nagios is, it's a monitoring platform that happens to be open source too, which I think is the greatest thing ever created.
Student 15?
Nagios is actually monitoring each and every one of you guys' clouds right now. Wow. So if you log into the monitoring dashboard of Nagios, you might actually get a little tip as to what service may not be working. I'm just gonna throw off. So follow the steps of step two. You've got step one mastered, and give it a go, all right? Now, step two, the whole process of step two is that you'd identify the service that's broken and try to fix it. And again, keep it simple, stupid, right? Keep it simple. If the service is not running or an API is not available, what's the first thing you go to look at? Is the service running, right? So go check that out.
5T4CK.
Let me know if I'm talking too much.
It should give you... Is this the Nagios box?
And you guys are still having a you having a tough time here?
Second
you okay?
box that was listed on that slide. Maybe it is. I have a sign that's, I know we're not 36, but it was whatever this one is. Nagios server.
Okay.
Yes, it is. So it's capital O, lowercase p, 3. All right, you want me to give it a go?
Yeah. Oh, wait, you know what? We're logging into...
You're trying to get to the Nagios server. No, you're going to the wrong server. You need to go OpenStack, the first one. I guarantee you'll be better then. So raise your hand if you've gotten to the Nagios dashboard.
Have to check,
just raising your hand to ask a question. Okay.
Yeah, okay. You might just catch it from Nagios.
Well, actually, you were just in the Stackstorm one. I don't know how you got in there, but you did great. You hacked into it. So with this guy, do slash
make
Nagios
sure up.
3.
That actually, he might have, You want to make sure. Okay, yours guys is going to be your
credentials are in
13?
Step 2.
Oh, so these are each different.
I don't think that's actually
each one.
Okay.
On the left-hand column.
Yeah, go look at step 2, the instructions.
So everybody's got a different alert.
I don't know if you'd be able
or
to.
Or not everyone has a different alert.
Yeah,
but
I think you can, so. So go back, okay. Go back one more. Now, step 2.
You guys got it?
And it'll actually give you the credentials there. Those are the credentials for Nagios. All right, so raise your hand if you got into the Nagios dashboard. All right, what did you find there?
Okay,
what's not running?
Okay, so this
what was
is
not running for
OpenStack?
You who found
the
Nagios dashboard?
Container with all the APIs in it.
This is going to be, it has OpenRC, and you guys can jump
it
from
works,
there
baby.
To the other.
Let me show it to you.
Jump out of the utility
containers? Running in the container.
Nothing's running.
Sure. We're getting a patch page. See, nobody's following the instructions. Why are you guys.
It's got an IP. There's no other instructions.
Yeah, yes, there are. There's a whole set of instructions. Watch. I'm going to show them to you. Okay. What is up with your Windows popping up like that?
It's called Linux.
Look at this. Step 2. There's actually a set of instructions in there.
I'm still on step
1. No, you're not. You should have got access to OpenStack Cloud by now already. All right, so who got to Nagios? What did they find? Huh? Ooh. Okay, interesting.
So everybody notices the credential as student 01 instructs.
You got a problem with me choosing the same username and password for everybody? Whatever your team number is, you go to that number in Nagios. Yes. See, you could just do it. You want to do the lab? Yeah. All right. Was there another question? I'm sorry. You good? Excellent. All right. Hopefully you guys are fixing those services. Oh, my goodness. I'm so excited. I see this guy. He has, like, the command line up. He's typing stuff. I saw him start a service already. I like it. Well, you got a lot of red. What'd you do? Oh, yeah, you highlighted all the failed ones. I like that. You just went right at it. Okay. All right, so I want you to do up to the end of step 2. So if you haven't found out that there are a set of instructions at the root of that GitHub repository, they say step 1, 2, 3, 4, you should be doing step 2.
So the password, I'm using this one?
Yeah, you just put that in the browser, and then that's the username and password.
Right, now we are trying to connect to the CLI.
You don't have to connect to the CLI.
No?
No, so what I'm asking you to do is What did I ask you to do?
LLS, we have to connect to this IP, right? SSH to this and run this. That's actually, we should have to connect to this one. And I think once
contain IP, but.
Yeah, so what I wanted you to do here is, and I probably wasn't very clear, is I want you to connect to the OpenStack server, go in and execute these commands on the OpenStack server, not on the Nagios server. Okay, so this was a hint. This was a hint to just kind of give you an idea as to how to find your failed service. But you know what? I can definitely do that a little better next time. I'm sorry. So you need to be connected to your OpenStack server to troubleshoot your OpenStack service, not Nagios. I would love for Nagios to be able to fix OpenStack one day, but we haven't gotten there yet. Okay. Is everybody almost done and getting through step two? No? No? That's it? Okay. Yes, sir. Yes.
It looks like the lowest scheduler is what's down, right?
Yes. Maybe. Who knows?
I don't know.
Yes.
This says SSH to the container IP.
Yes. So what happens is you did you execute that this command? Execute that command for me. LXC.
Okay,
you're in the utility container. You have to type exit to get out of the container. Yes. I want you to type.
That makes sense.
Yeah. So if you make that screen a little bit wider, there you go. So now you have the SSH to the container that relates to the service that failed. Right. There you go. So one thing, if you're not familiar with OpenStack Ansible, because that's what these clouds are running, they're running OpenStack Ansible, which is another way of deploying OpenStack using Ansible. The services are deployed in containers. And no, not Docker containers, because that's like the copy of the original containers. They're running in LXC containers. So in order to get to each of the individual services, you will have to connect to those individual containers that are running those services.
I know it's Glass API.
Okay.
The problem is I don't know where Glass API is running.
Oh, well, look at the container names.
Well, yeah, Glass containers, but...
Oh, check it out. Connect to it. See what happens.
Yeah, but...
Yes.
Oh, yeah. I see Glass registries.
Yeah, but all right. So how many services run Glance? How many services run Glance? Take a guess. Yes. You only see registry running on that server, right? WizGlance API. Come on now. I'm going to start running OpenStack tests shortly. Anyone took the exam, took the certification? Because if you raise your hand that you took the certification, you know I'm going to lean on you, right? No? Nobody took the certification? Oh, damn. We're going to get you there. Don't worry. We'll get you there. Oh, yes. Well, I just did it. Yes.
So we are up to here. We found the IP address.
Okay.
And we are trying to log in so that we can start the service.
Okay.
But I'm not sure what LXC...
So LXC, let's show the list of all the LXCs.
Yes. Yes, it does. Yes, yeah, so what I want you to do, so are you on the OpenStack, you're on the OpenStack server, first you got to connect to the OpenStack server, then you execute the LXC command, it'll give you the list of containers, and then you connect to the container.
Makes sense.
Yes.
When you say you have to go to the OpenStack server, you mean the IP address of the Horizon?
Yes.
So
you have the SSH to it.
So from the Horizon, you can see the LXC?
Yes.
So
well, when you execute the command and pull up the containers, you're going to find that containers have more than one IP address associated with them, right? I don't want you to use the 10-dot address. I want you to use the 172-dot address, right? But that's the reason why I gave you that as a placeholder, because each container has two addresses, if not more than two.
So that OpenStack is a jump box to the LXC.
You could see it that way, yes. Yes. Hey. No, so the container is running on the bare metal OS, right? And the reason why we And again, if you don't know this, Rackspace helped create OpenStack Ansible. The reason why we did that, run the service inside containers, is so that you can do in-place upgrades, as well as it gives you the flexibility to grow out your services footprint. Right, so let's say, for example, if you have a set of control plane and you see that your Nova API is being hammered all the time, you can spin up more containers on another machine or even on that same machine and actually run more instances of your Nova API. As well as when you do your upgrades, I can drop in a whole new set of containers, make the database update, turn off your old containers, and now you're running a new version of OpenStack. And that's the reason for that approach. Well, compute is different than the control plane. Control plane is going to run all your core services, right? So compute nodes is no big deal. Control plane is the big deal. Yeah. Yes, you should. You could. Yes. Sorry. All right, everybody almost done with step two?
So we logged into the server, right?
Yes.
So then we went into the container.
Yes.
So I can go all the
OpenStack. You got to exit out of you in a utility container right now. You got to exit out of there. Just type exit. Okay, so now you can actually pull up the list of containers.
Yeah, okay. So that's fine. So the container which we logged in was running all the OpenStack services, like all the controller services, right? But when we listed the hypervisor list, it actually gave the name of the
machine.
You know, the host where the container was running.
Yes, it's all in one, that's why. So you're running all the services and including your Nova compute all in one instance. So when you did a hypervisor list, it's only going to show itself, because it's all in one. It's not a distributed model, right?
So what's happening is you have processes that have containers inside that.
Yes.
And then that's nothing but the hypervisor, and you have all compute and everything
Yes. Yes. Well, you can look at it that way, yes. Because Nova compute, which is actually the hypervisor, is not running in a container. It's running on the base OS. But all the services are running in containers. So Nova, Neutron, Glance, all on the same server. You can do it. I would never do it for production.
But is it not like a chicken and egg problem because you're using the same server as a hypervisor to launch other VMs?
It's meant to just do test environment only. You would never do it in real life.
SLX is not running on the OpenStack. You're just running
Correct.
As a normal Linux container.
Yes. Yes. Correct. It's not triple O. No, it is running on those all containers are running on the bare metal. Pretty much. But better. Yeah. You should be done. You fixed your service? Everybody fixed their service. Raise your hand if you fixed your service. Fixed your service? All right. No? Okay, I'm gonna give you a few more minutes and then we're gonna progress. Yes. No worries.
The second one, step two?
Yes,
okay.
Please.
Right.
Yes. Who raised their hand? Was it you? Okay, it's you guys. Okay. Yes. What's going on?
We don't see it listed as a service. You see the process running, but when you do service status, all it's not there, and there's nothing in it.
I mean, it works when you
start. See, you got to deal with Tricky Ubuntu, man. You got to figure out how to make it work. So I'll give you a command. I'll give you an idea. Service, space, the service name, space, status. And that'll tell you whether or not the service is running or not. What? It don't look like it's running now, is it? So you can figure out. Yeah, there you go. Yes. You okay? Yes. Well, okay, so there is a small lag on Nagios. Nagios checks every 5 minutes. I could have turned that up a little bit, but I didn't want to kill that server. So if you recover a service and it doesn't turn green right away, you got to give it a few minutes. You can actually look at the next scheduled time for that check, and it'll tell you when it's going to check it the next time.
Yep.
All right, all right.
So we have a stop waiting, but it's still the Nagios is not showing critical.
Okay, just give it a few minutes. It's like I said, it runs a poll every 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
Yes, yes. No, it's not 90 seconds. It updates the screen every 90 seconds, but it doesn't change a poll every 90 seconds. All right, I'm going to see how you guys did. How about that? I can tell myself. So I'm expecting when I go to Nagios here, and I'm going to see all greens. All right, so who's team two? I'm gonna start calling people out. All right, I like that. Team three, you guys okay? You good? You found your service? All right, well, it'll be fixed even if you keep going on, because Stackstorm is gonna take care of it for you, believe it or not. Team 7 and 8, you guys okay? All right, well, I see that there's still some folks trailing. Oh, well, I got a lot of greens here. All right, so if you're still working on step 2, it's okay. I'm going to move forward. And we can always circle back. I'm not going to walk out as soon as I'm done. I'm going to give you time if you need to ask questions or we need to do something else. So if I could just get your attention for a few minutes here, because I just want to share some information with you about StackStorm. So anybody here ever heard of StackStorm before? Okay, that's good. So you get to learn something today, right? So StackStorm is an open source project. And its focus is on integration and auto. I want to make sure I say it right. Its platform is for integration and automation across services and tools. It ties together your existing infrastructure and application environment so that you can more easily automate that environment with a particular focus on taking actions in response to events. So the reason why this tool is really helpful and cool in a sense that services are going to fail. Right? And there are always going to probably be people around to maybe restart it. But what if service fails at 3 o'clock in the morning? Right? You get a Nagios alert. That's great. Your NOC calls you and tells you it's failed. That's great, too. Now you got to climb out of bed, find your RSA key, VPN in, connect to the cloud, and hopefully recover the service. Right? Maybe an hour later, you get back to bed. Maybe. But with something like StackStorm, the NOC never gets a chance to call you. Because StackStorm actually will restart that failed service for you. Now, the thing about StackStorm that I love is that it's customized. It's not just you accept it as it is and you go, but you can customize rules in StackStorm to do specific things for your cloud, as well as anything else in your application stack, because it's not just for cloud, right? It's for anything in the application stack. So some of the common automation things that people use it for is facilitating troubleshooting, or automated remediation, continuous deployment. I've never tried that one, but that'd be pretty interesting to use a tool like this for. So this is how it kind of works. And again, this diagram says a lot of information. So don't get wrapped around the handlebars with it. But it shows the different components, how you can have different integrators, such as OpenStack, integrators such as Nagios, obviously, Amazon Web Services, but we're not going to talk about them because this is an OpenStack summit, not an Amazon summit, right? But you can have different tools that integrate into StackStorm, and what happens is you can have an input that comes from any of those tools, go into the StackStorm world, do what it does, because we could, you know, it's too complicated to kind of describe just right now, and then have an output, right? So the key factor is that if a tool can give an input, so let's say, for example, a service fails, or you get a notification goes out that a service fails from Nagios, right? Because that's the example we have here. So you guys found your cloud, you found that a service had failed. Nagios sent an alert. But guess what? You can configure Nagios as an event handler to send an alert to StackStorm. And what StackStorm will do is it will evaluate that alert and that message and say, do I have a rule or trigger based off of the message I just received that's going to tell me to do something? If it's no, it does nothing. If it finds a trigger that matches, then it evaluates and say, do I have a rule that matches this failure? If it's no, it does nothing. But if it's yes, it does something. And then what it'll do is it'll actually create a trigger which will go off and do an action and go back and actually do something to the integrator that it actually received a message from. So if you're following where I'm going with this is, StackStorm has an integration pack to Nagios, right? So Nagios can send global event handler messages to almost anything. It doesn't really matter, right? So what I did is, for the sake of this, is I configured Nagios, the same Nagios you guys were logging into, and told it, you have an event handler. Whenever any event happens, send a message to a StackStorm server, right? And then that StackStorm server then will listen continuously through its APIs for that message. So the simple requirements for Nagios was I had to add and enable an event handler, which took literally a minute in Nagios. You had to go in and enable access for the StackStorm APIs. So you have to be able to talk to those APIs from your Nagios server, which takes another 2 seconds, and then create a custom Nagios command to be able to send across those custom parameters. And what I'm showing you down here is an example of what you would put inside of a miscellaneous conf file for Nagios. And it's really simple, as you can see. You name the command, and then you give it a URL, but you give it a command that it will execute. Right? So this is the StackStorm Python file that comes with the integration for StackStorm and for Nagios. And you just basically pass it a whole bunch of Nagios variables. Nothing major there. They're all pretty straightforward. You can exactly copy this. I won't charge you for it. And once you configure Nagios to be able to send this alert, every time something happens, it executes this StackStorm command. And what in turn it does is that in turn then sends a message to StackStorm. So we're going to start now, step 3, right? So get back in there, go to the GitHub repository. We're going to go to the file named step 3, and I want you guys to start working through that. And what step 3 is going to do is it's going to introduce you to StackStorm. It's going to kind of show you how to create a rule in StackStorm, and we're also going to see it actually in action, right? For your cloud. So start step 3. Raise your hand if you have any questions, okay?
Is there something I want to pull up? No. I guess we can just have them.
Cool.
You cool?
Yeah. Amen. We never bring that out.
All right. Oh, I see your hand up already. We're coming. Sure.
What's going on?
No process name. I just have the same function, so we cannot restart.
So the key API is not.
Oh, okay. So it was never. It was stopped. So here, actually, let me turn this.
You know what? Honestly, I don't think it just has to be Nagios. The reality is as long as you can configure your tool to send out an alert to StackStorm, and have some control to format how the message appears, then you can integrate it. That's really the prerequisite.
So StackStorm will basically have a list of handlers for every single notification, I'm assuming?
Yeah, so it has a list of handlers that it knows and it has integrated to. You can also write custom ones.
Okay.
And then on the other side, it has a list of actions that you can take. And it's the actions that are going to help you recover these services, right? Because there's different actions, whether it's run a command remotely, run a command locally, you can actually try and have to go after tell it to restart a service. Like, there's all kinds of actions. We had to do something a little bit different because you're running services in containers, so I just couldn't tell it to restart a service.
Okay.
But instead, what we're doing in this example is we're going to use Ansible. So since OpenStack is built with Ansible, you can actually execute remote Ansible commands to do things in your cloud. So you'll see that when you open up the rule and look at it, you'll see the command being executed there.
Perfect. Thank you.
And the StackStorm on the Nagios runs on 2 different machines?
Yes. They're running they're running 2 different machines.
Then they can just communicate with
Yes. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. StackStorm. Everybody loves it. Woohoo! Yes,
so
that's fine.
Want to restart the service.
Mm-hmm.
You're not sure.
Did you figure out which service failed? No, not yet.
It says heat here. Heat
API. You need to go to Nagios. You want StackStorm. You got to close that browser.
Yes. This one.
Okay. So go back to your command window.
Right.
All right. So.
Heat is here.
Okay. So your heat container is that guy. What's the IP address? 172. Right, so you need to SSH to that IP. It's actually root, but that may not work for you. Yeah, just do root. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ubuntu is all about root. It's not admin.
Oh, okay. 172.42.238.138.
You wrote 238. Sorry, I'm one of those guys. Attention to detail. Right. So now in here, if you issue a service type service, space, heat dash API, space status. Right. You see, it's not running. Right.
Okay.
So, if you do, I think you figured it out. What's that? Yeah, it doesn't matter. Right? So, did it run?
Running.
Yeah, okay.
Where did you, how did you know the service name is heat-dash API?
Oh, that's here.
Well, it's actually there, but I just happened to memorize.
Oh, okay.
So, one thing you realize over time is you start to memorize the name of the services. It's just one of those things. So it's kind of weird because there is no like view all services in Ubuntu. Like there's no real command to really do that successfully. You can do ps-ef and then pipe and then do a grep for that service, and that's how you can find the service name. But there really is no like show me everything running. It's just. No. See, that's the thing about OpenStack as an operator. Yeah, you need to know. Like, you really need to get familiar with how the services run in your cloud, because there is no OpenStack command to tell you whether or not their service is running, right? Because think about it. Let's say, for example, Keystone had failed. If Keystone is down, you can't get to any of the rest of the OpenStack services through the API or the CLI, because Keystone is down, right? So you have to, so this is what I tell everybody. You have to embrace the command line, and you have to kind of have a solid knowledge of Linux to really know where your services are running. Like, you really have to have, like, that groundwork. I know I just said a lot, but the reality, what I'm basically saying is that you have to get Linux. You have to become a Linux admin at that point, not an OpenStack admin. No, and again, for this case, you had to be in a certain container for that command to work, number one. And number two, if it was Keystone, that command wouldn't do anything. So I don't want you to get comfortable with relying on OpenStack CLI commands. I want you to be comfortable as a Linux admin to know how to trace down your services. That's it. Hmm? How are we doing? We creating those rules? I want to see my StackStorm rules populating. Hey.
Changing every time.
Okay, so what I'm pay close attention. You must name your rule based off of your team number. Please don't name it someone else's team number. All right. And I need you to put in the IP address of the OpenStack server that your team is part of, not somebody else's. It's very important. Yes. Yes.
Like you change Nagios for that, were there changes required in Nagios?
Yes. I showed the one command. The only thing that you have to add to Nagios is add that command to your miscellaneous config file. And then you tell. It's called an event handler. Yeah, if you Google Nagios event handler, it'll tell you exactly what you need to do.
So
yes.
Should have the same name or it can
which one? The file itself can have the same name. It just
the same name. Oh, I just changed the name in this file. Should
that's
I change the same on the two?
No, it doesn't matter. The name of the file actually doesn't matter. It's more about the name you give the rule in the file.
Yes.
The name of the file doesn't matter.
No, I mean, the rule name in the file for these three files should be the same. Is that
no.
I
well, you can you can make it whatever you want, but it has to be changed.
Okay.
It has to be changed to something.
So they have to be the same.
Yeah. You know what? It's been around for a little bit, not too long, and it's not OpenStack related, but to me, it was like a third-party tool that like could solve a lot of problems.
Sure. Okay.
So yeah, it's not. But hold on 1 second.
Make a replacement of this thing.
Yeah, so inside, so you need to put in the IP address of your OpenStack server. No, they're not. Okay, so if you're having a problem executing that command, I found this personally to be a problem. If you copy and paste out of that the instructions, the little single ticks are weird. And no matter how I did it, and no matter how I tried to show it, when you copy and paste, those ticks become weird. You need to go back in, once you paste that line, and change the single quotes to be real single quotes. I don't know why it keeps doing that, but it did it for me too. So the single quotes get weird. You got to fix those up in your commands. That's because someone named it the same name. That's why. Yeah, you just got to pick a different name. So if you open up the file, just change it to Yabba Dabba Doo. Like, as long as the name of the rule is different, that right there, it just, you'll be fine. Someone, I don't know who stole yours, but someone did. So if you find that someone else has created a rule with your student number or name or some exact one that you did, just pick another name for the rule. Doesn't matter what the rule is named, but it needs to have a... Apparently they are, yes. I'm sorry. Yes, please.
I'm sorry, I was
That's okay.
busy working on the other ones.
No problem.
I didn't realize what's happening. Can you explain me what's happening?
Sure. So what I'm trying to do is just kind of demonstrate how if you pull down this repository, it'll show you some examples of how to create StackStorm rules.
Right.
And I just basically want you to look at the rule, then I need you to make a change. And I need to tie the name of the rule to be something custom. It can't all be the same because everyone is connected to the same StackStorm server, so it has to be unique.
Okay.
And then I need you to go down here and put the IP address of your OpenStack server in those quotes.
Okay.
Right. And just be conscious of wherever you see a single quote, you're going to have to go in and fix it, because when you copy and paste this, it's going to give you that weird single quote.
Gotcha.
You got to blame GitHub for that one. I don't know what GitHub is doing there.
That's going around is, so if we are setting some list of rules, say if this is a service that's failing,
yep.
Okay, you go and remediate if you see the particular keyword or something. How does it check?
You'll see when you go to look at the rules, you'll see exactly how it's doing. It uses regular expressions.
Okay.
StackStorm uses regular expressions.
Okay.
So you can put in a regular expression to query for a particular thing to look for.
Okay.
You can give it multiple conditions.
Okay.
And once it meets all those conditions is when it will do the action.
So I'll define everything in the AML pretty much to go and check. So now
yes.
It just has to trigger that and talk to the StackStorm server.
Yes.
And then StackStorm server is pretty much in the OpenStack?
Well, no, it's not. Oh, it's a separate instance.
Okay.
And StackStorm, funny fact, StackStorm uses an OpenStack service called Mistral. Which is supposed to Mistral, I always say it wrong. Which it does it's supposed to be like event processing. So StackStorm actually uses an OpenStack service to do it behind the scenes. Totally separate thing, but it uses the same code, right? No, it's already running on a StackStorm server. Yes. StackStorm uses that same code from OpenStack. Totally separate thing, not part of your OpenStack cloud, but it uses the same code. Yes. MISTRAL.
Okay. So the StackStorm server are talking to the OpenStack servers or whatever variable VM
is,
and they try to remediate the problem.
Yes.
Right.
There you go.
Okay.
That's it. Yes.
Okay.
It's nothing against StackStorm, but why can't I just have an Ansible script running? Why can't I make this handler to call a plain Ansible script?
You could, but the problem is that it may not be as flexible, right? So you can create an Ansible script, and you can try to feed in variables, but it may not be as flexible. It may not. Who knows? It could be.
Or does
right.
StackStorm has other capabilities?
It has other capabilities.
Well,
I'm not going to explain those, but it does have other capability, right? It has integration to many different things. And to me, it's meant to do that. It's meant to listen for events and do something. Ansible is not created to do it. Ansible is created to run a command.
Based on the signal that comes from
yes.
Chaos, you are just calling a playbook.
Yes. Well, yes. I'm calling a playbook I'm actually calling Ansible to do something on that OpenStack server. Not a playbook. It's actually an ad hoc command that we're calling when you look at it.
One-liner
yes.
Ansible.
Yes, absolutely. You know Ansible really well. Make sure you come get my book. I am giving away.
Ansible?
Yeah. OpenStack administration with Ansible. We're giving them away at the cantina across the street at Rackspace. Rackspace.
I think the
Rackspace.
First rule we created it.
Yes.
Well, the second one, I think there's a duplicate key error right there.
Yeah, so whenever you find a duplicate problem, just go back into that rule and just give it another name, whether it be Yabba Dabba Doo or I'm number one. Somebody probably used the same name to create a rule, so don't get hung around that. Just the biggest thing is making sure your rule has your IP address of your OpenStack server,
okay.
Right? That's the biggest key. The name of it doesn't matter. Hey.
I want a bolt. Is there any way I could grab your card and take you up on that offer?
Absolutely. Absolutely. There you go.
Awesome. Thank
you so much. Just reach out to me, man.
Awesome.
All right.
Cool.
Take it easy. So the biggest key is that the name of your rule does not matter. What matters is you don't change anything else in there, and you make sure that the IP address is pointing to your OpenStack server. Those are the only things that matter.
So
yes.
Server IP will be this one, right?
Yes.
Which we are replacing in the files?
Yes, please.
Okay. The OpenStack server, not
yes.
the StackStorm.
Not the StackStorm server. You wouldn't create a StackStorm rule to point to itself, right? We want to make sure the rule is going to point to your OpenStack server so that it can connect to it and fix your service for you. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. .yml. .yaml is YAML. That's simple markup language. It's the same language you use to write Ansible, which is used to write many other things. Yes, sir. None. Yes, I love to wear swimsuits in the winter.
There are 21 people now logged in to student01 in the same directory. Somebody was walling earlier, so is there anybody else in this?
Yeah, I realized that.
It won't matter if the rules are the same, but they're all trying to edit the same file.
Yeah, well, yeah. Thank you for that. Yes. Yeah, everyone is connecting. So please, if you're connected to the StackStorm server as student01, unless you are team one, please log out and log back in as your team number, student, whatever team number you are. Please. Thank you. Is that it?
No. The thing is that it says sudo su. So
yes.
Everyone becomes root.
Oh.
Then git clone, everyone works on the same version.
Well, not if they git clone before. No, I see your point. Yeah, that's a valid point. Thank you. It's probably too late now, but yeah. No matter how many times you step through a lab, it's always going to be something. It's always going to be something. But I appreciate that. You probably could have run that command without SUing. Yeah. Yeah. No. Thank you for that. I will fix that for the future. I'm assuming you know how to get around that since you are a really smart man. So. They're just editing the file and everybody's overriding each other. Yes. Yeah. I think they get the gist of it though. That's hopefully somebody is successful. Yeah, I found it's a small bug. Okay. That sudo su was putting everybody into the root, and everybody's git cloning, and then now everybody's overwriting each other's file.
Yeah,
and
what you're talking about.
And then everybody else was logged onto the same student ID, too.
Yeah,
which
everybody's using student one. So, hey, man, let me learn. It's a lab.
Hopefully folks are figuring out. If you're having any trouble, I probably know what you're encountering. I apologize in advance. Yes.
I believe today we are only going to see very simple examples of restarting the services.
Yes.
But I believe in real scenarios where we have a lot more complex issues, like even if we restart it, it keeps on failing.
Yep.
Or maybe dependencies between the DB servers.
Yep.
How do we really overcome these parts?
Well, think about it this way. If you go to start a service and it keeps failing, that means there's some other residual services dependent on that's not working, whether it's MySQL or whether it's, you know, if you're the Nova scheduler, maybe Nova computer's not running. There are ways to create rules to do that. I didn't want to go there because I think the message might get lost. But basically what you have to do is create more complex rules in StackStorm.
Are there any samples for those complex rules?
I have a few I can send to you. No, it doesn't restart the server, it restarts the service.
Restart the service.
Today is only the very simple part, right?
Yes. And believe it or not, it is a lot of service failures that it's not catastrophic. Unless somebody messes with your config, then that's a whole other story.
So, this system just can be able to detect the failure.
No. No, Nagios detects your failure. StackStorm fixes your failure.
No, first of all, is to detect. Without detection, how can you discover?
You can't. That's why you need Nagios.
Right. You detect it.
Yes. Nagios detects the failure.
Huh?
Nagios detects the failure. StackStorm fixes the failure.
Right. It detects the failure by doing what? By pinning it or send the Hadoop
page? Yeah, that's what Nagios does, yeah. It checks. However many whatever interval you set it for, it will go and check. It will go and poll it over and over again.
So the server itself must expose an interface or something, meet the standards, for instance, provide a standard REST API for it to call or something.
Well, think about it this way. If you have all those servers on the same network or networks that can communicate with each other, that's all that's required. It doesn't have to be public facing, right? Inside your data center, you can set up multiple networks. As long as those networks can talk to each other, Nagios can talk to your OpenStack cloud and check it. And then once it detects a problem, it can then talk to StackStorm and send the message to StackStorm. It's all about network internally. It doesn't have to use any external APIs or anything. It's all internal networking. Yeah. So what I use for Nagios is SNMP.
You simply ping the server if it's
similar. Yeah, no. Yeah. I understand what you mean. Right. The standard I use for Nagios, I use SNMP. You never heard of SNMP before?
Okay, sure.
Right. SNMP. Yes. So SNMP, through SNMP, I can ping a server, pass it an SNMP community string and tell it to do something and it'll give me back a response.
So what kind of standard you are using here?
SNMP. I use SNMP for.
No, the service uses SNMP to detect whether the service is healthy.
Yes.
If it's not, it generates events and triggers the stack storm.
Yes.
To take some action.
Yes.
And from there, you have a policy file or you change rules.
Yes.
And tell the stack storm what to do.
Yes. Exactly.
So possibly it can switch this service to another server.
Yes. So,
okay, thank you.
You cool?
So, what standard is the policy file follows? I mean, what language the policy is?
Right. So Nagios has a few alerts, right? So it goes warning, then critical, critical soft, and it does that twice before it does critical hard. Once it goes critical hard, that's when it sends a notification generally. And that's when it sends a message to StackStorm to say, I've now gone critical hard, and StackStorm then can take action. But it's not until it goes critical hard that it takes action.
It takes action
right.
Based on the configuration file.
Yes, based on the rule. Yes, based on the rule.
That means that what format does the configuration file follow? Is there a standard?
It's YAML. It's a YAML.
Huh?
YAML.
YAML.
Yes.
YAML itself is a standard.
Yeah, that's a markup language. Mm-hmm. That's the standard for it. You guys making it okay? All right. So anybody make it to step four yet? Anybody move on to step four? All right. Anybody see their service recover on its own? All right. At least I know it works for somebody. While I have you guys, before I forget, there's free book signings today at the Rackspace Cantina. If you don't know where the container is or what the container is, you'll find out in the next slide. But we're actually giving away books. We're giving away four different books. The OpenStack Cookbook, the Neutron Networking book, the new book on troubleshooting OpenStack. Yeah, you actually do. Sorry. You'll get to leave in a few minutes, don't worry. The new book, a brand new book on troubleshooting OpenStack just came out, so you can't tell me you have it already. And then last but not least, they'll be giving out my book, which is OpenStack Administration with Ansible. So that starts at 3 o'clock. Quite honestly, if you are done and you feel good about yourself, you can proceed over to the cantina, which is on 2nd and Trinity. We have drinks and Wi-Fi and couches and free books. Free books! Woohoo! So head on over to the cantina. Free books. Everybody loves a free book. It is at 2nd and Trinity. So literally, if you walk back down 2nd, where you came from, it's right across the street. It's a restaurant across the street from the convention center. If you walk back down 2nd, it's on the right-hand side, right before you walk into the doors of the convention center.
It's second floor, right?
No, we have the whole restaurant, so you won't miss us. Yes. Yeah, huge sign for Rackspace out front. Please.
I just started working on Ansible.
Yeah. Well, you got to come. You bet. My book signing starts at 4:30, and you can talk to me as much as you like. I'll be over there. I'll be back.
I'm from Juniper.
So Juniper, excellent, excellent. Actually, I was supposed to. I think I was supposed to do something with you guys. Somebody once upon a time. Anyway.
I mean, I kind of newly joined, so maybe you would have worked with my other senior folks.
Okay. Okay. No, that's fair. That's fair. Let me ask, before you leave, did you have a good time?
Yeah.
Can I hear one more time? You have a good time?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, guys. I have another workshop on Wednesday. If you want to hackle me, please look it up. Yes.